This poem is shaded indeed by something, a little detail from my childhood, because I was a very troublesome girl. The teachers used to force me to stay with some other boys or girls who were very quiet or my opposition. One of them was a guy, a boy, who had a very serious problem with his heart, and everybody knew that he didn't have a future. So the question of his death was only a question of probably months or a few years. But it was very curious and interesting how everybody used to look at him as looking to somebody or something without future. And so I created this poem in the sense of I gave a lot of examples of what it means to be stamped by destiny. And perhaps one of them, it's me. When I talk about the polar bear and survivals, it's me. A friend of mine used to say to me, why you kick the door when the door is open for you? That's what it means, you know, to live for, to go on for inertia, of having the idea that nothing changed, or having that fear that you are not safe anymore, and you are not in normal society, and your destiny is in your hands. So that's a poem. Marked. My deskmate in elementary school had blue nails, blue lips, and a big, irreparable hole in his heart. He was marked by death. He was invisible. He used to sit on a stone, guarding our coats, as we played in the playground, that alchemy of sweat and dust. The one marked to be king is cold, ready for a free fall, born prematurely from a sad womb. And a red-headed woman waiting for her drunk husband to return will go on waiting for 100 years. Not the fault of alcohol. She's marked by waiting. And he's guilty as the onlooker pushed indoors by rain. What's more, it is not the fault of the war that the young boy with melancholy eyes lost his life. He was marked as well, born to be on the recruiter's list. Melancholy is a standard arsenal of war. And then there is one marked for survival, who will continue to eat his offsprings like a polar bear that never notices that warming climate. All of them are closed as theorems, their sky a rental home, where hammering even a single nail of change is forbidden. They are waiting for their next command, which they will ignore anyway, like the Argonauts who filled their ear with wax and rode on through the siren's path. And perhaps I should read the Albanian version of this poem too. And we can see that Albanian version is too much more linear than it is in English version. And boring, I'm afraid. Me fati në shkruar në fityr, marked. Shoku imi bankës në shkollën filore, kishte gishta blu, pus blu, dhe një vrim të pari parueshme në zemër. I shënuar me vdekje, i padukshëm. A i vetëm ruan të robat i ullur mbi një gurë, jashtë fushës së lojës, asaj alkimie djersë dhe pluhurin. I shënuari për të qenë mbret, është i ftohtë, i gatshëm për një rënje të lirë, i lindur para kohe nga një mitër e palumtur. Gruaja flokuqe që pret për natë burrin e pirë, do të vazhdoj të apres kështu edhe 100 vjetë. Nuk është faji alkoolit. Ajo ka pritën vullosur në fytyrë, dhe i ndodhet kresë rastisht në këtë akt, sa spektatori i rastit që shiu e futi nga rruga në sallë. Po kështu nuk është faj luftës që i merr jetën djaloshit me sy të trisht. Ai është i prerë për listat e rekrutimit. Melankolia është arsenali bazë i ushtrive. kurse ai që është i vullosur me mbijetesë do të vazhdoj të ushqehet me këlysht e tij si ariu polar, pa e marrë vesh kurrë se moti është ngrohur. Të gjithë të mbyllur si teoremat, qielli i tyre është një shtëpi e marrë me qira, ku nuk mund ngulesh sa zë një gozhë më tepër. Në pritjet një urdhri të dytë, të cilin do ta injorojnë gjithsesi. Me krahët e lidhur pas lëpatave dhe veshët zënë me dyll, si njerëzit e Odiseut në shtegun e sirenave. The reader, I think, must know that what happens in some communist countries, especially Albania during the communist regime, perhaps they know about the persecution of clerics and destruction of churches and mosques, and the religion was forbidden at all. Nobody could practice their religion. And they were persecuted, surveyed, and jailed, and executed in some cases, especially the Catholic priests. They were considered it was considered obscurantist, you know, the effect of religion in the people. So I don't have a religious education. I had to read Bible only when I was 30 years old, so after the political changes, and also the same about Quran. And I feel a kind of deficit in my education, not having such, let's say, a religious information about or religious tradition I come from, or a religious culture. And another thing is that in my home, and I think everywhere around, praying to a god was considered kind of weakness, like complimenting a beautiful woman or like expressing your feelings. I mean, you can see that I'm trying to sketch kind of harsh or cruel reality where everything, any connection with something invisible, mysterious, which was not touchable, which is not concrete, was ignored or was considered like weakness. The mystery of prayers. In my family, prayers were said secretly, softly, murmured through sore noses, beneath blankets, a sigh before and a sigh after, thin and sterile as a bandage. Outside the house, there was only a ladder to climb, a wooden one, leaning against the wall all year long, ready to use to repair the tiles in August before the rains. No angels climbed up, and no angels climbed down, only men suffering from sciatica. They prayed to catch a glimpse of him, hoping to renegotiate their contracts or to postpone their deadlines. Lord, give me strength, they said, for they were descendants of Esau and had to make do with the only blessing left over from Jacob, the blessing of the sword. In my house, praying was considered a weakness, like making love, and like making love, it was followed by a long, cold night of the body. Okay. I am going to read two parts of the long poem, Monday in 7 Days. So this part of poem is about what I just tried to explain about. Monday in 7 Days. Broken toys were my playthings, zebras, wind-up Chinese dolls, ice cream carts, given to me as New Year's presents by my father. But none was worth keeping whole. They looked like cakes whose icing had been licked off by a naughty child until I broke them, cracked and probed their insides, the tiny gears, the batteries, not aware then that I was rehearsing my understanding of freedom. When I first looked at a real painting, I took a few steps backwards instinctively on my heels, finding the precise place where I could explore the truth. It was different with people. I built them up, loved them, but stopped short of loving them fully. None were as tall as a blue ceiling. As in an unfinished house, there seemed to be a plastic sheet above them instead of a roof, at the beginning of the raining autumn of my understanding. I just changed something. I think I like that. I didn't say where I could explore its depth, but I suddenly said when I could, where I could explore its truth. So I think both versions are acceptable. And also the another part of this poem is the ninth part, part number nine. And here it is. As is said in Latin, medio tutis musibis, the embroidered tablecloth in the middle of the table in the middle of the carpet in the middle of the room in the middle of the house in the middle of the block in the middle of the town in the middle of the map in the middle of the blackboard in the middle of nowhere. Lola is an angel. Her forehead hasn't grown since she was 8. Her sandal of gravity unchanged. And she likes edges, corners, although she always finds herself in the middle of the bus, where people rush towards the doors at either end. My neighbors never went to school, nor have they heard about aesthetics, and hardly ever have they read anything about the Earth's axis, symmetry, or absolute truth. But instinctively, they let themselves drift toward the middle, like a man laying his head on a woman's lap, a woman who, with a pair of scissors, will make him more vulnerable than ever before the day is done. Memory. There is no prophecy, only memory. What happens tomorrow has happened 1,000 years ago, the same way, to the same end. And does my ancient memory say that your false memory is a history of the feather-hearted bird transferred into a crow atop a marble mountain? The same woman will be there on the path of reincarnation, her cage of black hair, her generous and bitter heart, like an amphora full of serpents. There is no prophecy. Things happen as they have before. Death finds you in the same bed, lonely and without sorrow, shadowless as trees wet with night. There is no destiny, only laws of biology. Fish splash in water, pine trees breathe on mountains.